हेलो, टुडे वी शैल सी ड्राफ्ट एंड ट्विस्ट इन रोटर स्पिनिंग। ड्राफ्ट एंड ट्विस्ट ऑन रोटर स्पिनिंग। इन अ रोटर स्पिनिंग मशीन द ड्राफ्टिंग टेक्स प्लेस इन बिटवीन द स्लाइवर फीड रोलर एंड द यार्न डिलीवरी रोलर। इट इज़ अ रेशियो ऑफ स्पीड्स बिटवीन दीज टू पार्ट्स। ड्राफ्ट में ऑल्सो भी कैलकुलेटेड फ्रॉम द हैंक वैल्यू ऑफ द यार्न एंड द स्लाइवर। As we already know, draft is equal to surface speed of delivery roller upon surface speed of feed roller. Number of turns or twist per unit length is equal to rotor RPM upon length delivered per minute, which is the surface speed of the delivery roller. So from the above formula, the draft value can be set on a rotor spinning machine by changing the delivery speed or the feed roller speed. As we can see, in the draft formula, I can either change delivery roller speed or the surface speed of the feed roller to change the draft value. But change in the delivery speed will directly affect the twist per unit length. So by this formula, we can see if I change the surface speed of the delivery roller, it will directly affect the twist per unit length that is inserted in the yarn. And it will also affect the production levels. Therefore, the drafts are only changed by changing the feed roller speed. So, what are the kind of draft levels in rotor spinning? The draft values range from 60 to 400. But we must remember that there are very high drafts that are involved between the feed and the rotor groove, which is to the extent of 25,000. And this high drafts are there because we have seen in the process, the sliver is completely opened out to the fiber level, individual fiber level. And by the time the fibers come to the rotor groove, the total draft that we would have applied would be 25,000. But as the fibers reach the rotor groove, the yarn that is formed will be consolidated over there for the formation of the yarn. And at the rotor groove, the fibers are collected layer upon layer. Before they are twisted. So basically condensation of the fibers is happening for the production of yarn, and here you will have a very very low draft values which are less than one, and the overall effect of this high draft and the very very low draft at the rotor due to fiber collection, the total effect or the total draft would therefore come down to 60 to 400. Both rotor and air jet spinning, this air jet spinning we shall be seeing later, both produce yarn from sliver. But in case of air jet spinnings, due to the low drafts that are involved there, since the spinning machine, the air jet spinning machine cannot handle high drafts, the slivers that we need to feed them has to be finer. Such kind of problem is not seen on rotor spinning, where there are very very high draft values that are involved here. So from the normal draw frame slivers, which range from 5 to 6 kilo tex, I can easily produce finer counts up to 50s any with just a draft of 400, which is the normal or the highest draft value that I can apply here. A positive effect of draft values is seen on the quality of the yarns spun from coarse slivers using high drafts. Now it is what is being said here is that the application of high draft leads to a quality improvement in the yarn. If I'm using high drafts with coarse slivers usage, then the quality of the yarn is improved, and this happens basically because the moment I apply a high draft, we saw from the earlier formula that to increase the draft, I will have to increase the or rather decrease the feed roller speed. Sorry, it's in the denominator in the earlier formula. So to increase the draft, I will have to reduce the speed of the feed roller, and the lower feed roller speed will allow the fibers to spend a longer time in the opening roller zone, which will result in better opening of the nips and effective release of dust and impurities if there are any in the feed sliver. So now let us see the twist and the effect of twist on strength. So in this particular slide, what we see is that the angle that the fiber makes with the yarn axis decides the feel of the yarn. So this angle that this fiber makes, that is theta, with the yarn axis, it will decide the feel of the yarn. That means whether the yarn is going to be harsh or whether it is going to be soft. The fibers in the outer layer of the yarn will have to travel more, leading to increased tensions. So from this figure here, we can see that the moment we keep on increasing the twist in the fiber here, there is some sort of lateral pressure that is shown by the red arrows over here, which will try to compress this yarn more and more as the yarn twist goes on increasing. So this pressure comes because the fiber has to travel a distance around the circumference, and in this process it might be stretched a little bit, and anything that is stretched will try to come back to its original shape and size by contraction. And in this method, that is, it is trying to contract. So because of that, the result is that it will try to compress the yarn towards the axis of the yarn. So there is a lateral pressure which is acting. So lateral compressive pressures start acting inwards on the yarn due to insertion of twist. And we see the effect that more the twist, more is the angle made by the fiber on the surface, more will be the lateral pressure over the circumference of the yarn, and the yarn becomes more and more compact. So as the yarn goes on becoming more and more compact due to the higher insertion of twist, there is an increase in friction between the fiber, and because of there is an increase in surface contact between the fibers, and they do not allow the fibers to slide past each other. They sort of become locked. And because of this locking phenomenon, the yarn strength would increase. So in short, more the twist, more will be the yarn strength due to the lateral pressure. Therefore, the factor that determines the effectiveness of the twist is the angle that the fiber makes with the yarn axis. Therefore, the yarn with a large fiber angle will be more wiry and harsher, while a yarn with a fiber that makes a small angle will be softer and bulkier. So let us now see the influence of the same twist. There is a opposite effect in this case due to the obliquity effect. Let us study this. So in the diagram which is just shown here, what we see is the same count of yarn, three yarns are shown. And the only difference in each of them is that the twist has been increased from 1 to 2 to 3. And what we see is the fiber inclination has changed as you go on increasing the twist. The fiber gets more and more inclined and slanted as compared to the yarn axis. And what we see is, if we were to measure the angle between the fiber inclination and the yarn axis, which is theta over here, it goes on increasing as you go on increasing the twist. So during twisting, another factor influences the yarn strength, and it is the obliquity of the fiber to the yarn axis. The contribution of the fiber strength F to the yarn strength is equal to F cos theta. So if we were to calculate the contribution that this fiber strength makes towards the yarn strength, which is in the vertical direction, it would be F cos theta if F is the fiber strength. So now let us see the range of theta. Now theta can range from 0. 0 means when the fiber is lying straight in the yarn, that is, it is parallel to the yarn axis, and 90 degrees would be it is lying perpendicular to the yarn axis. So these are two extreme cases that are the values that theta can take. So therefore, cos theta. So cos 0 would be 1, and cos 90 would be 0. And so cos theta will take values from 1 to 0 in the extreme cases. And the contribution of the fiber strength to the yarn strength would therefore be F to 0, because cos theta takes 1 to 0 values. So F cos theta would take values from F to 0. In figure 1, theta is small and it increases as the TPI increases in figure 2 and 3 respectively. Therefore, as a twist is increased, the yarn strength will keep on decreasing as the fiber becomes more and more oblique or slanting to the yarn axis, which we just saw maximum would be when the fiber is which is F, which is lying straight in the yarn structure, whereas if it becomes more and more inclined due to the increase in twist, this contribution of the fiber strength towards yarn strength would become zero. So let us see the relation of twist and strength for a spun yarn. So we see this, there is a figure A over here, the graph, which shows an increase and then it goes on decreasing as the twist goes on increasing. This is the yarn strength, and this graph has come due to the obliquity of the fibers, which we have just discussed. So in the beginning, since the yarn is lying straight, and as it goes on becoming more and more inclined due to the increase in twist, the yarn strength due to obliquity will keep on decreasing, and you will get this graph. So when you look at the coherence curve, this is due to the lateral pressure that we have already discussed. So in the beginning, since the twist is low, the lateral pressure would be low and this yarn strength would be low. But as you go on increasing the twist, the lateral pressure goes on increasing, and the graph takes this shape where the strength will go on increasing. So there are two opposing effects, one due to obliquity, which where the yarn strength decreases, and the other due to lateral pressure where the yarn strength goes on increasing. So the yarn strength is maximum in the beginning and then goes on decreasing due to obliquity effect. Simultaneously, the yarn strength is minimum and then goes on increasing due to increase in the lateral pressure, which is shown by B over here. So the combined effect of these two curves is this curve C, which is the actual combined or the resultant strength that we see with the increase in yarn twist. So initially the yarn strength will increase, and later on it, after it reaches a maximum value, it will the obliquity effect will start dominating, and therefore the yarn strength will go on decreasing. So we can see the entire discussion in this particular diagram over here. What we see is twist will go on the x-axis, it goes on increasing. Twist also means that TPI is increasing, or even the, because TPI is increasing, theta will increase, and also a factor known as TM, which we will study shortly. All these three are on the x-axis, which is increasing, and the effect of increase in twist on strength is seen here in the graph. Initially it is increasing and then decreasing. So the stage 1 over here, where the increase is happening because increasing strength due to the increase in lateral pressure on the fibers, and this 2 is the optimum level, and the stage 3 where it starts decreasing, it decreases due to the increase in angle made by the fiber with the yarn axis. So, and after a certain point where twist goes on increasing, you will come to a stage where it is breaking strength. So these three stages can be shown with the help of this diagram, where both the effects are shown in all the three. In the first one, at stage one, we can see that the lateral effect is very less. That means the strength will go on increasing as you go on increasing the twist. It the red arrows, as you can see, the intensity has increased from 1 to 2 to 3. So therefore the strength will go on increasing due to this. And the second effect that you see is the inclination, that is theta. From 1 to 2 to third diagram here, the theta goes on increasing. And because of this obliquity effect, the contribution of the fiber strength to the yarn strength goes on decreasing, and we see the decreasing curve here. And somewhere in between, you will see the optimum strength or the maximum strength for a certain amount of twist that we insert. There is a stage where you will get the maximum strength for a certain amount of twist that is inserted. So from this graph, we see a combined effect of increase in strength due to increase in lateral pressure and a simultaneous decrease in the strength due to the increase in obliquity with the increasing levels of twist. So let us analyze the same thing for a continuous filament yarn. What we saw earlier was for spun yarns. So let us see the twist and strength relation for a continuous filament yarn. Here there are two graphs shown. B is the one shown for spun yarns, which we have already seen, the way it increases, reaches a maximum and then decreases. So let us analyze what happens with the continuous filament, and the curve A shows the effect of twist on yarn strength for a continuous filament. As we can see, in the beginning it just slightly increases and then goes on decreasing. A small amount of twist is inserted in the multifilament yarn to keep the filaments together, and this twist reduces the problems that may arise in weaving and knitting processes, which shall come later. So in a multifilament yarn, normally some amount of twist is given so that the filaments are kept together and they do not give rise to any problems in weaving and knitting. So in case of a continuous filaments, the curve shows a slight increase in the strength in the beginning. Now this happens because of the same effect that we saw earlier due to the lateral pressure. Now in a multifilament yarn, there we will always see a variability in strength from filament to filament, and there may be some weaker filaments in the yarn. So in the beginning, when as you go on increasing the twist, the lateral pressure, the effect of it will start supporting the weaker filaments in the yarn, and therefore we see a slight rise in the strength. But as you go on increasing the twist, the obliquity factor will take over, and which then suddenly leads to a decrease in the strength as shown in A. So now we know that theta, that is the angle that the fiber makes with the yarn axis, is the important factor, and but at the same time it is a difficult thing to measure. So we can see that if we want to measure it, it can be easily measured by measuring the TPI, or the twist per, that is twist per inch or twist per meter, which are relatively easy to measure. There are instruments which can measure TPI. So in the figure now here, we see that there is a yarn which is shown with one single twist or turn, and the length that it covers, this one particular one single twist in the yarn would cover, and which is written as L, and D is the diameter of the yarn, and theta is the angle that the fiber on the surface of the yarn makes with the yarn axis. So if we were to open out this yarn and spread it over in a two-dimensional way, what we see is this is the fiber which makes an angle theta. L is the length covered by one single twist in the yarn, and pi d would be the circumference if d is the diameter of the yarn here. So in the figure, t is the twist per unit length. In that case, L is the length covered by one yarn twist, which is L is equal to 1 upon T. If theta is angle made by the fiber with the yarn axis and D is the diameter of the yarn, then tan theta would be opposite side upon adjacent side, which is pi D upon L, which is equal to pi D into T when I substitute 1 upon L as T from this equation. But we also know that diameter of the yarn in inches is equal to 1 upon 28 root of English count. So if I were to substitute this value in the above equation here, I will get tan theta is equal to pi into 1 upon 28 root English count into t. Since this factor here is in inches, this t would be in twist per inch. Now therefore, T, since the yarn diameter is in inches, it will become TPI. And when I reshuffle this entire equation, TPI on one side, and take all the other factors on the other side, we get TPI is equal to tan theta into 28 into English count, which has come in the numerator, divided by pi. Now in this equation, we see that 28 is constant, pi is constant. So if I were to replace this constant and tan theta with one say term, which is a twist multiplier, I would get an equation as TPI is equal to TM root English count, where TM is tan theta into 28 upon pi. So we have got a relation between theta and TM, and we can see that there is a direct relation. So this TM is an indicator of the angle that the fiber makes with the yarn axis. So twist multiplier and twist factor. So we already know this formula now from the earlier discussion. TPI is equal to TM root English count or Hank. When expressed in direct system, it will be twist per meter, and I will have to replace this English count by tex. So tex will come in the denominator, and this term, instead of twist multiplier, we call it twist factor now in the direct system. So twist per meter is equal to twist factor upon root of tex. Yarns are compared with respect to their handle based on the angle that the fiber makes with the yarn axis. This yarn angle is directly proportional to the twist multiplier or the twist factor. That means this twist multiplier is an indicator of the angle that the fiber makes with the yarn axis. So the effect will be same when I see the effect of twist multiplier on the say yarn properties. So two yarns having the same TM shall be equally soft or equally harsh. Twist multiplier defines the character of the final product. It decides the stiffness or feel of the product and the strength of the yarn. Higher the TM, harsher is the yarn, and vice versa. So increase in TM will lead to harsher yarn, and if I were to decrease the TM, it will give me a softer product. So let us see this with the help of an example here. So we have yarn, 36's count and 64's count. Each of them, I see that I would give the same twist multiplier. So when I have the same twist multiplier, that means the angle that the fiber makes with the yarn axis would be same. So I represent it with this figure over here, where this would be the coarser 36's yarn count, and this would be the 64's yarn count. And since TM is the same, the angle of inclination of the fiber towards the yarn axis would be same, which is shown here. And if I were to calculate TPI using the earlier formula, TPI is equal to TM root count, I get TPI as 18 for 36's count and 24 TPI for 64's count. So from this example, we see that we need to insert more TPI in a finer yarn to maintain the handle of the yarn. So if I were to maintain the handle, that means harshness, softness, etc. I want to maintain whether even if there is a change in the yarn count, in that case I must see to it that the TM is the same. So the effect is that even when I keep TM as same, the TPI changes, and we see that as the yarn becomes thinner, greater is the amount of twist that has to be inserted to give the same effect. So greater is the amount of TPI here that I need to insert in a finer yarn to keep the handle of the yarns equal. So we come to example number 2 here, where we see that we maintain the TPI in both these yarns, and we see the how it affects the TM. So the same yarns, but here I calculate TM from equal TPIs, which is 18 in both these yarns, and I see that the TM is 2.25 for 64s and 3 for 36s yarn. So since this TM is lesser here as compared to 36s yarn, what we see is the inclination is also lesser here towards the yarn axis. And this you can see it is inclined more towards the yarn axis, and there definitely there will be a change in the properties of these particular two yarns. From this example, we observe that maintaining the same TPI leads to a change in TM, also the angle made by the fibers with the yarn axis. The 64's yarn will be more softer than the coarser 36's yarn due to the lower TM. Here, that since the TM is lower, this yarn will be more softer in feel as compared to this yarn. Although twist is measured in turns per unit length, the ideal amount of twist should therefore vary with the thickness of the twisted material. Therefore, TM or TF is the characteristic that influences yarn properties. So twist and its effects, the necessary evil. Twist is inserted in the staple yarn to hold the constituent fibers together and thus gives the yarn the necessary strength. But although the increase in yarn twist increases the strength in the beginning up to an optimum level, in practice, when we actually apply twist, we never do it to the twist level where it leads to optimum or highest strength, but always the twist inserted will be lower than that value. And this is because insertion of twist leads to certain negative effects in the yarn and the fabric properties. One of the effects that it will have is on the harshness or the handle property it will affect. More the twist in the yarn, harsher will be the yarn and harsher will be the fabric made from it. So to keep the fabric softer, I need to insert low twist, although it will be a little bit of compromise on the maximum yarn strength that can be achieved. We also see a deterioration in the aesthetic properties, in the sense that there's a decrease in the luster of the yarn and the fabric, because as we go on increasing the twist, the fibers go on inclining themselves more and more, becomes slant towards the yarn axis, and this leads to non-uniform reflection of light, and therefore it will decrease the luster. Then the third property that it affects is the thermal transmission. As you go on increasing the twist, the entrapped air within the fibers is released, and air is the insulating element in the yarn structure. So if the air gets released with the increase in twist, the thermal insulation decreases, and this effect is seen. Some of the other application based effects of high twist levels are, so one of them is moisture absorption and the increase in water repellence. As you go on increasing the twist levels in the yarn, the water absorption capacity will go on increasing, and therefore you will have a increase in water repellence. Now this happens in case of a gabardine fabrics where they are made with high twisted yarns, and it will have a good water repellency. On the other hand, if you were to make wipes which requires it to have a good moisture absorption property, then you will go for a low twisted yarn to make these kind of wipes. High twist levels also affect wearing properties. One of the important properties that it affects is the abrasion resistance. So if you have a high twisted yarn, there is a increase in the abrasion resistance, and that is because all the fibers in the yarn will start going into the yarn body as we go on increasing the twist. They are incorporated in the yarn body, and therefore it will lead to reduced hairiness and reduced pilling also. So on the other hand, what we see is a fabric made from soft twisted yarn will be soft, no doubt, but will also exhibit an increase in pilling and a lower abrasion resistance. And both these effects would be because of the increased hairiness. That means the fibers are not bound so well into the yarn body. Some other properties that twist can affect are cover factor. So with the increase in twist, the fabric that we make from the highly twisted yarns, the fabric will be more open, because as we go on twisting, the fiber becomes thinner and thinner, and therefore the fabric will look more open. It will also affect the air and moisture vapor permeability. As you increase the twist, the air and moisture vapor permeability for the fabric will go on increasing. It also affects the wicking property of the fabric. As you go on increasing the twist, the air capillaries within the yarn will go on decreasing. And because of that, wicking, which is a property where there is a transport of liquid from one end to the other, because of the absence of yarn capillaries, it will reduce. So therefore, we see a decrease in wicking property due to an increase in twist due to the decrease in capillaries. So selection of TM for rotor spun yarns. When the fibers to be processed on rotor spun yarns are of low strength, the loss in strength due to the low orientation of fiber in the yarn structure has to be compensated by increasing the twist multiplier. So what we are trying to say here is that when we are using fibers of low strength in a rotor spinning system, we already know that rotor spinning will always give me a lower yarn strength due to the low orientation of the fibers, and therefore if we use low strength fibers also, it will lead to further deterioration in the strength. So to compensate or increase the strength, I need to increase the twist multiplier. So therefore higher TMs for our cotton are used as compared to the blended yarns, because in blended yarn maybe we will use polyester, which will lead to overall increase in the average strength of the fibers, and therefore I can do with a slightly lower TM when compared to cottons. Same thing goes for viscose polyester and acrylic. Since their fiber strengths are very high, I can go for a lower TM, which will of course give me the advantages of improved certain yarn and fiber fabric properties. So now we come to this graph where we see this effect. There are four types of fibers that are used: carded, combed, cotton polyester blend in 50-50% and viscose. So as we can see from the graph, on the x-axis there is a yarn count and there is a twist multiplier. What we see here when we compare, as we go on the count, that it goes on finer and finer, I need to increase the twist multiplier or increase the TPI to increase the strength, because as it becomes finer, the yarn will become weaker. At the same time, if we were to compare the four types of fibers that we are using, in case of a carded cotton yarn, we see that we apply a highest TM because the fiber strengths are low. As soon as we comb the cotton fibers, due to the parallelization or the orientation of the fibers during combing, I can do with a lower TM. Then we see the cotton polyester, due to the addition of high strength polyester over here, I can further reduce the twist multiplier. And in case of viscose also it is the same, I can manage with lower twist multipliers. Also, higher twist multiplier is used for warp and weft, used for weaving, compared to the yarns used for knitting. So we'll see another graph now for knitting. We can compare that. When we see that for knitting, the yarn properties that are expected is higher bulk, hairiness and softness. So if we need these properties in the yarn, I should go for a lower TM. So for the same fibers, the arrangement or the TM levels are going in the same order or the same sequence. Cotton carded would be highest, cotton combed would be lower than this. For cotton polyester, lower TM is okay, and viscose somewhere it's almost the same. They almost are the same and they cross over at a certain point. But when you compare these values with those twist multipliers that are used for weaving yarns, then you see that in case of weaving for cotton carded, the values were 4.3, 4.5, etc. Here it has come down to 3.6, 3.8, 3.9, because it's done on purpose, because in knitted yarns we expect higher bulk and softness, so we reduce the twist multiplier, which will lead to a reduction in the angle of the fibers with the yarn axis, and which will lead to a softer yarn for me. Twist insertion in rotor spinning. The number of twists inserted in the yarn or rotor spinning depends on the amount of time spent by the yarn in the rotor. If the yarn is withdrawn from the rotor rapidly, that means if the withdrawal speed is very high, then the fewer turns will be inserted by the rotor and vice versa. So this can be easily seen from this formula. If I increase the delivery speed, yarn turns per meter would decrease because it is inversely proportional. Therefore, the twist per meter has to be adjusted by changing the delivery speed for a given rotor speed. In conclusion, from this entire lecture, the conclusion we can have is draft in the rotor spinning must always be changed by changing the feed roller speed, and the twist or the twist multiplier has to be adjusted by changing the delivery roller speed. So we see a numerical where we calculate the twist per meter and the production in grams per hour from the given data. So in this table, we have been given yarn count, then we have been given twist multiplier, we have been given twist per meter, the row I have just hidden, because we are trying to calculate it from the given values. Rotor diameter in mm is given, rotor rpm is given, we need to find out the delivery in meters per minute, efficiency is given to us, and we need to find out the production in grams per hour. So we can try to calculate this, and all of you can, for practice, use the remaining columns. We will try, solve the first column over here, and you try it on your own first, and then pause this video and go further on to see the values. So twist per meter is 382, delivery meters per minute is 210, and production is 1262. Similarly, you can calculate for all these columns for practice, and check your answers with those given in these rows. So the solution is that for the first column, twist per meter can be calculated by this in this manner. Twist per inch we know is TM root count, which is 4.1 in the first column, multiplied by root of 5.6. Since this will give me TPI or twist per inch, I need to convert it into twist per meter by dividing this value by 2.54 and multiplying by 100, which gives me a value of 381.9, which is written in the column as 382. We have to find the delivery speed in meters per minute, which from the formula that we have seen earlier, depends on the rotor speed and the twist per meter. If I reshuffle the earlier formula, I get delivery speed in meters per minute is equal to rotor RPM divided by twist per meter, which comes to 209.42, which is rounded off to 210 in the above table. We have to find out the production in grams per hour from the delivery speed. Since the delivery speed is in meters per minute, I convert it to meters per hour by multiplying by 60. Then to convert it to grams, I need to multiply by the tex value divided by 1000. So to calculate the tex value, I take it as 590.5 divided by 5.6, which is the count given to us, and divide by 1000. This will give me the grams per hour. And since the efficiency is given, I consider that, which is 95/100. And my final answer for production in grams per hour for an efficiency of 95% would be 1262. So we come to the end of the lecture today. Thank you.